The memory is engraved in my mind. It was 2003 or so. A few of Dr. Pfeffercorn's former students still in touch with him, met for lunch at one of North Toronto's finest kosher establishments. A bit late, Dr. Pfeffercorn finally ambles in with that impish smile of his. He is, as all of us always knew him, keep up hanging off the side of his head, baggy sweatpants, short sleeve shirt, pencils in the top pocket. He looks the part of either an Oxford don after a sherry or two, or a starry-eyed kibbutz poet after a day in the orange groves, and then followed by a night struggling to versify about the glories of some swampy patch of the Galilee. Out of his pocket, he pulls a warm can of Dr. Pepper soda, which one of the students had with black marker turned into a can of Dr. Pfeffer. "You must drink," he says, in a rip-roaring parody of Jesus' Last Supper. "You are my disciples." I think many of us who are here today have similar memories, as well as the feeling that we were indeed his disciples. By means of this sort of initiation and the thousands of other ways he found to reach his students, we were elevated into that larger world of ideas, and especially Jewish ideas, which he made it his life's purpose to transmit. I'll be very brief, I just want to say a few words about those ideas and the substance of what he taught. Pfeffercorn had a very broad and deep intellectual world, and he always had an interesting word on subjects ranging from the theory of the absurd, or the subject of his PhD, Isaiah Berlin's political philosophy, Mozart, as well as, of course, the kind of personal gossip that he would no doubt excuse as educational. I think in terms of his teaching, I think he spoke through primarily three themes. The first was the centrality of the greatest texts in Jewish history, from antiquity down to the 20th century, for an understanding of the core of Judaism. In his teaching of Jewish history, Pfeffercorn always emphasized what one might call the great books, the writings of Josephus, the Mishnah and Talmud, the Kuzari, on and on. In all of this, he preempted the account of Jewish history, which one might encounter if one studied the subject in university, that Jewish history was merely social history, a story about a despised people whose brief moments of glory were followed by persecution and dispersion, and that the greatest texts of our history, however interesting they may be, were merely related to their own times. By teaching an example, Pfeffercorn revealed that the issues in, say, Judah Halevi's Kuzari are very much alive today, if one could train one's eyes to see them. Pfeffercorn's second teaching theme, I think, was a revisionist, I use that word advisedly, the history of Israel, particularly in relation to the experience of the survivors. Teaching us, as he did, the miraculous history of the creation of modern Israel, Pfeffercorn nonetheless showed us how the Yishuv and the early state adopted a rather narrow, even sometimes unsympathetic attitude toward the survivors. And when it finally chose to make the Holocaust a core principle of its national life, it emphasized the heroic aspects of resistance, the gvura in Yom HaShoah, and gvura, rather than experiencing the Holocaust as a whole. So unlike certain new Israeli historians, such as Tom Segev, whom Pfeffercorn, I remember, called an intellectual vulture, when it was very well known, Pfeffercorn never offered these reflections in order to merely debunk myths. He was an expert debunker, but that wasn't his central purpose. What he wanted to do, he was trying to elevate, and doing what strikes me as so necessary to do in our time, which is to think through and connect the story of modern Israel with the broader story of the Jewish people and Jewish ideas. To speak personally for just a moment, my study of Israeli history with Pfeffercorn prepared me much more thoroughly for teaching and researching the subject in university than did courses in Jewish history and interactions with celebrated historians of Germany and some of the world's finest universities. Pfeffercorn's final theme was what one might call the psychology of the Holocaust and the evil that lay behind the Holocaust, an evil which, in his view, was no way banal. Pfeffercorn taught us the Holocaust through the most sophisticated and complicated texts that have analyzed. Himself a follower of Primo Levi, he also gave us the best recent biographies of Hitler, and even forced us to reckon with primary accounts by ex-Nazis like Hermann Reuschning and the apologetics of Albrecht Speer. By means of these texts, Pfeffercorn helped us to see that Nazism, in a way, is easier to understand than typically thought. Nazism, he showed, is an outgrowth of Hitlerism. Understanding Hitler as evil is a key to understanding the Holocaust. Here, too, I think Pfeffercorn helped protect his students from facile explanations they would encounter in university and in the broader world, where the Holocaust might be blamed on anything from capitalist exploitation of the German working class, to the logic of modern bureaucracy, to the unwise economic policy of the 1920s, to say nothing of the malicious explanations which are now again cropping up in certain parts of public life. In guiding us through these subjects with his piercing intelligence and biting wit, Pfeffercorn equipped his students for the fierce battles that were to come, and are to come, on the most important questions facing the Jewish people. How lucky we were to learn from him. How worrying it is that we often fall so very far short of the standards of saying.